The topic of this video is very special to me because it's the slogan of this channel, Explore Weird Machines. So in this video, I want to introduce what a weird machine is and use it to explain return-oriented programming. But let's start from a clean slate. Please forget the term return-oriented programming and weird machines, and let's start with something else. I really want to show you this really weird programming language I made. It's a really terrible language, but let me show you some example programs. Here is a simple hello world. In this programming language, you first have to initialize the program, and then you can start writing actual instructions. So here we set the variable 4 to the string hell. And then we store that variable 4 in memory location 1. Then we set the variable 4 to O space WO and store variable 4 again in memory location 2. And lastly, we set the variable 4 to RLD exclamation mark and store that value in memory location 3. Cool. Next, we want to print it. To do that, we have to prepare the two parameters for printf. The first parameter, that will be the destination variable, is set to the memory location 1. The memory locations are continuous memory, so printing from location 1 will print the whole string. And the second parameter of printf will just be set to 0. It's just a printf of the hello world string. No printf format modifiers and parameters here. And at the end, we exit. All in all, a bit ugly language, but makes somewhat sense, right? Pretty simple. So let's run this program. First, we have to compile it with this Python compile script that I wrote. Python compile.py helloworld.weird, that's the source code, and the name of the out file, so helloworld.binary. Let's quickly look at the produced binary in the text editor. It starts off with some weird readable characters, 1, 1, 2, 3, and a lot of A's, but we can also find our hello world snippets in here. Hello world, the other values are just gibberish. But let's run it. To run it, you have to simply cat, so print the binary file, and pipe the output into the interpreter, called invoice. Okay, I know the output is really confusing, but that's just part of the weird invoice program, so just ignore that invoicing menu. Because all the way down here at the bottom, we can find our output. Hello world. Awesome. Let me show you some other examples. This here is a simple echo program. It reads a string from standard input into memory location 1 and then also prepares a printf with the memory 1 location to print that string. Again, we can try this out by first compiling it, and then we have to output the binary and pipe it into the input of the invoice program. But not only that, we should also execute cat so the input doesn't close and we can send more input that we type to the program, just some Linux command line foo, don't worry about it. But the fact is, when we execute this, the program waits for input, we can type something in, and the output is here. It worked. And please ignore the invoice gibberish menu around it. Let's do another example. I'm really proud of this one. This will read a string into memory location 1, then it will execute string to integer on that value. So we have to enter a number. The result, so the raw integer number, will be in the result variable. Then we initialize the variable 4 with 0 and add the result to this number we entered to it. Then we store that value into memory location 2. Then we read another number as string and convert that string also to an integer. Now we load the old value from memory location 2 back into variable 4, and then we add the new converted integer in result to the variable 4. And then we prepare a printf, but this time we have two parameters. The first one is of course a format string. The programming language has a few hard-coded format strings like this string 1 here, and as the second parameter we have our variable 4. Cool, let's try it. We compile the sum program and execute it again with cat. Then we enter the first number, then the second number, and we get the calculated sum output. Okay, you ask yourself probably, what is up with this weird programming language? Why am I showing this here? Well, the only reason why I showed it was because I need you to fully agree with me, this is a programming language, right? we can write programs and we can somehow compile them and then they get executed. Simple, but also very weird looking. So let's have a quick look at the invoice program. It's actually a regular simple C program. When we just execute it alone, we can, for example, add an invoice, enter an amount in euro, add a comment, we can add a few more to just get a feeling for the program, and then we can select options like calculating the sum of all invoices, or we can just finalize and exit. After entering our name, we get a nice list of our invoices. So, wait, what? This is an invoice management system? So how can this program execute these other programs? What? This doesn't make any sense. Let's look again at the binary of one of our compiled programs. We know this is given as input to the invoice program. So let's just try to copy that. And maybe we also run it with GDB. So run the invoice program, then we select one, add an invoice, it asks for an amount, we enter 1, 2, 3, and then comes all these A's. Let's copy those, add a bit more at the end. Boom. Segmentation fault. RIP, the instruction pointer is 42424242. So BBBB. We have caused a buffer overflow and overwrote the return pointer on the stack. Bam. Maybe you think now, this was just a buffer overflow and our programs were just shellcode in assembler. But nope. When you check the security flags, you see that the non-executable flag is used. And looking at the memory layout, you can also see that the stack or heap is not executable. So how can we execute these programs even though we can't inject assembler as shellcode? To answer this question, I would like Sergey Bratus to introduce the concept of weird machines from his talk, What Hacker Research Taught Me.
Lesson two is what I call composition creates weird machines, parallel universes of computers. Any complex system turns out to be casting many shadows. And of these shadows, only one is what you intended. This is the development environment that you work on. Everything else is a weird machine whose instructions are actually combinations of your well-designed features, but it will run the attacker's code and do exactly what we defined as undermining your trust assumptions, leading to behavior which is entirely unexpected by the designer of the machine. So think of stack overflows. Think of heap overflows, which are even more interesting. In each case, you have a component of your actual machine that is executing instructions that the exploit, the crafted input, can trigger, that you did not intend it to be executed in that fashion. It's a whole universe of weird machines. So exploitation is, from that point of view, programming of that weird machine via crafted input most often. And so here's one case study from 1997 when a technique called returning to libc was invented to what the academia now calls return-oriented programming. And it took about over 10 years to propagate. All the work in these series of techniques is done by code fragments already present in the trusted code. So no new executable code is introduced. No new attacker code is introduced. All the manipulation, all the activity is done by parts of the machine that you thought were your friends. Well, no, they are traitors lying in wait. In 2008, when academia finally got a firm understanding of this brand of technique, it was dubbed malicious computation to distinguish it from malicious code, which is what your eggshell, which is what your exploit is.
The concept of weird machine is so beautiful, and that realization was very impactful to me. Thus, it became the mantra or slogan of my channel. Return-oriented programming is one example of using a weird machine, and the weird machine we have here is implemented in the invoice program. The invoice program implemented one intended machine, the invoice management system, but also implemented an endless amount of weird machines due to a stack buffer overflow. The developer has crafted a weird machine without even knowing it. A weird machine so powerful that it can execute basically anything. So powerful we can create a programming language that only runs on this single weird machine. Isn't that amazing? And remember, we do this without injecting arbitrary assembly instructions. We don't have shellcode here. We are using the technique of return-oriented programming to achieve arbitrary execution. And it's so weird and it's so beautiful at the same time. In the next video, I want to look closer at the weird programs that I've written and what the compiler does and how exactly this is executed. And if you haven't already guessed it, let me give you a small teaser. You could call these instructions actually gadgets. Wink, wink. So next video, we will learn how return-oriented programming works. But in the meantime, please go watch the talks I've linked below and read the papers I've linked. For me, they belong to the most important computer science and hacking or IT security papers.